Hey there, I hope everybody had a great weekend. So this week we're going to start going through tools. So for the next few lessons, a lot of the focus is going to be on the tools, you know, the things that you find all the way on the left side of your screen. And we're going to start with the brush tool because I find it's the most intuitive and sort of the most kind of the one that makes the most sense to us. I think because we grow up coloring on paper with pens and pencils and crayons. And the brush tool works very much like pens and pencils and crayons. So let's get started. We're going to start with a new document. So we're going to hit Create New. Let's go over here to Width. Let's go to, 2,000 pixels. And 2,000 pixels in height as well. That's good. Yeah, so it should be 2,000 by 2,000. RGB is fine. All your settings should be saved from the last time you used your, from the last time you closed Photoshop. So I'm going to hit Create. There we go. Go ahead and select your brush tool. Now you can do this by hitting the B button, or you can go over here to the tools area and just click on brush. So let's go over just a few keyboard shortcuts that you're going to find very useful. If you want to scroll, move your artboard up or down. Well, actually, we have to be zoomed in a little bit. I'm just going to scribble some junk on the board to give you a little reference. Okay, if you want to go up, you just scroll your mouse wheel up. If you want to come down, scroll it down. Now, if you want to go left, actually, I have to remember this, hold down Control and scroll, yeah, up to go left. So I'm scrolling my mouse wheel up. If you want to go right, scroll your mouse wheel down. This is all while holding Control. If you want to zoom in, hold your Alt key and do the same thing. So I'm going to hold Alt and I'm going to scroll in. Okay. And then I'm going to keep holding Alt and then roll my wheel the other way and I can scroll out. Super helpful shortcut. And what happens if we hold Shift? Oh, that's right. If you hold Shift and scroll up and down, it goes up and down really fast. This is not, I don't find this very useful in Photoshop, but I find it very useful in another Adobe product called InDesign, where you have a lot of artboards lined up a lot of times, you know, vertically. So if you have 42, you know, boards lined up vertically, it really helps to zoom up and down faster. Oh, here's another really great shortcut. We're going to have to just talk about what this means, but hold down your Alt key. Hold down your right mouse button and move your mouse around. You're gonna see that this big red dot appears and all these numbers change. So here's what this is. If you hold down Alt in your right mouse button and bring your mouse left or right, it just changes the size of your brush tip. So for example, here the brush tip is pretty huge. It's 327 pixels. You'll very rarely do that because that's gigantic. I'm going to bring it down to, yeah. Now, if you go up, watch what changes. The hardness. If you bring it down, the hardness goes up. Oh, that's confusing. If you bring it down, it goes up. If you press up, it goes down. Well, anyway, the hardness gives the brush a little, technically speaking, it reduces the opacity increasingly as it moves away from the center of your brush tip to the edge. So it's totally transparent by the time you reach the edge of your brush tip. Actually, maybe it's not totally transparent. It looks like it has it extends beyond the tip. But anyway, so it gives it a very soft look. It might ordinarily look like this. So those are the shortcuts. Now, speaking of which, let's go over some of the brush settings. So let's go over to our brush palette over here. And if you do not see your brush palette, I gave you a rule of thumb in the last video of where you can find your palettes. Do you remember where on the screen you can go to reveal new palettes? Ask yourself. Window, up here. This is where almost all of them are hiding. So if you can't find something, go to window and see if it's there. Here you'll find brushes right here. It's checked because you can see my brushes palette up there. But if I unchecked it, my brushes palette has disappeared, right? Where do I go to get it back? Just go right up here to window and click brushes, and you get your brushes palette back. Not bad, right? It's a really good rule of thumb. Remember that. So I'm gonna break it out of there just so we can look at it a little more closely. And it tends to kind of expand a few features when you do it this way. So I'm gonna actually close a few features that I do not want at the moment. Actually, that's not what I wanted. Yeah, there we go. Actually, what I wanted was brush settings, my mistake. Has a lot more options. So let's look at the first setting here on brush settings. Ah, stop. Thank you. I'm gonna move my mug over here. So brush tip, you might kind of be able to tell what that means just by the name, but when you click brush tip, you're gonna see a lot of different little default brushes here. And Photoshop comes with a good number of default brushes, but you can actually download a whole bunch more for free online just by giving it a search. There are a lot of different resources for graphic designers, and people create new brush tips and they upload them and they allow you to use them for free, which is really cool. But let's look at a few of the defaults. So here's a nice round one, super run-of-the-mill, right? The fuzzy round one. You could actually do that by just adjusting these settings I just described to you. So it's not too special. Okay, let's see what this is. Let's make it bigger. Okay, so it has a little bit of a shape to it, right? The brush tip looks like that. I just clicked. Go ahead and click this next one you have. You might have the same ones. You might have a few different ones. I've downloaded stuff, and I can't remember whether these are the ones I've downloaded or whether they come with Adobe out of the box. So we'll see. If you have one that's similar, it might look like this. If not, you might have something different. So you click it once real quick like that, and what do you see? Well, what you see is the shape of the brush tip. Now click the next one. Make your brush tip real big by holding your Alt key and your right mouse button and adjusting the size, and give another little click. There you go, another brush size. I mean, a brush tip. Do the next one. You know, hold Alt and right mouse button and make the size bigger. There you go. So lots to choose from. And you can't really tell whenever you're drawing, whenever you have the brush tip, it's much smaller. You can't necessarily really tell too much that it's a different tip. But when they get a little bigger, it becomes a little more obvious. It does look like you're sketching with like a piece of chalk or something. So I'm gonna choose something a little bit more generic, just this generic circle. Let's look at some of these other elements on the brush tip shape menu. So you have size. We already know one way to adjust that. I'm going to show you yet another way, but here's a third way. Adjust that here. And it's kind of cool that it shows you a little bit of a preview below, by the way. So let's make it kind of big. Flip X and flip Y won't make sense with a circle. Let me choose, this one's a distinct, no. Okay, I guess this will do. Watch the preview that we have down here. Or maybe I'll do this. I'll make a little imprint, boop. Right. Now let me hit flip X. What happened? It flipped it along the X axis. And anybody who's taken algebra knows that the X axis is the one that goes along like this. Let's flip it back over. There we are. We're identical to the first click there. Let's say flip along the Y axis. So now it looks like the first little stamp of this brush tip I did, except now it's flipped this way. Or it's flipped along the y-axis. And as anybody who's taken algebra will tell you, the y-axis is the one that runs up and down, right? So of course you can click both of them and you'll have sort of like a total reverse of the original orientation. Let's unclick those. Now, as I touched on just a little bit in our last lesson, this little guy here allows you to adjust the angle of the brush tip. So just for demonstration purposes, we'll move it 45 degrees counterclockwise approximately. And there you go. And you can adjust the width of the brush. So let's make it real, I'm gonna make it real skinny. So it's the exact same brush tip, but they squished it down. And you can see a nice little preview here below at the bottom of this little palette. And as I may have mentioned last time, I find that the whole angle thing comes in a lot of use when writing calligraphy. Of course, it comes in use whenever you're trying to simulate anytime you'd have sort of like a brush that's thicker on one side and thinner on the other. Here's the angle in case you want to actually say, oh, 45 degrees. I said 45 degrees earlier just as a off the top of my head, but you can actually technically set the exact angle. See, the roundness is how thin you've made it. So I think 12% is saying it's about 12% as thick as it was. I don't know. Does that sound about right? 50? Yeah, it's about half as wide as it was. 80? Oops. There's 100. Let's see, 80. Yeah, it looks about 80%. That makes sense. Now, spacing. No, that's okay. We'll keep it like this. Okay, the way the brush tip actually works is not exactly like a pencil. You know, a pencil, you put it down on paper and you run it, and it's dropping particles of graphite along the whole stretch of the paper. But a computer probably could do that, but I imagine it would take a lot of processing power. So it uses a little bit of a shortcut. What it's actually doing is it's just stamping the brush tip again and again and again and again and again at small intervals. So you can't really tell, especially when your brush tip's small. So, I mean, if I did this, you can't really tell. It just looks like I'm dragging a pen along a paper, a pencil along a paper, right? Let's make it much bigger. Can you see it? Now you can, right? It's stamping. Now, right now we have spacing at 4%. That means, and I think that's default, and that means that every time your mouse moves 4% of the width of the brush tip, it's going to stamp again. So let's move it down to 1%, and you're going to see a real smooth or much smoother stamping. That I can't even tell. Oh yeah, there we go. You can tell. Oh, another shortcut. To move the canvas around, hold spacebar and click and hold your left mouse button and move it around. That is super handy. But yeah, I don't know if you can tell, but I can see it. It's real faint. You can see that stamping right there, right there, right there, right there, right there. 1% of the brush tip's width. So how do you think it would look if you changed it to 100? I'd expect to see the brush tip stamped again and again and again and again and again, side by side, shoulder to shoulder. So let's see if that's what happens. That's about what I expected. Did you get something different? If so, put it on canvas. Let me know about it. You could even go do something wacky like 612% of the width, and then it would only do it when you've moved your mouse six times the brush width, or 6.12 times the width of the brush. So I'm holding down the left mouse button. You see that? It's stamping very sporadically. Not very useful, but kind of fun. So I like to keep it somewhere around the default, unless there's a reason to change it. And there sometimes is. Let's go on to the next little menu here, shape dynamics. So sometimes with some brushes, you want it to look a little more random. A pencil or a pen, especially a pen stroke, it's not very randomized. I mean, we're both trained to expect a really solid, smooth line when we use a pen, as opposed to what we expect to see when we stand 4 feet away from a wall and spray with spray paint. Right? If we spray with spray paint, we'd be very surprised if a pen line came out. It's because it responds differently. And so we can simulate that effect with a lot of these menu items. One of them is shape dynamics. So whenever you spray with spray paint, or even better, if you're Jackson Pollock and you take a brush and just splat it into some paint and then, just do that on an artboard, we really expect to see something very different than a pen stroke. We expect to see a lot of random stuff. So here's how to get, and every tool has every little tool in real life, I mean, you know, a paintbrush being swung in front of a canvas, a spray paint can being sprayed on a canvas or wall or whatever, and a pen on a paint canvas, a brush with watercolor, they all react a little differently. And Photoshop tries to help us simulate these. So size jitter means that every time it stamps your brush tip, it's gonna do it a slightly different size. So 0% is great for a pen because we don't expect to see the size changing a whole lot. But if we take a paintbrush and whack, like do that on a canvas, we expect to see every droplet have quite a bit of size jitter, right? So let's adjust it pretty dramatically, 100%. And, oh, by the way, the keyboard shortcut for brush is B. Now look at that. Let's actually adjust. Let me hit undo. Go ahead back to spacing. Bring it up to 50 or so, around 50. Okay, go back to shape dynamics. And bring size jitter all the way up to 100%. And color around on your artboard, see what happens. Do you see it? It's changing sizes pretty dramatically. I mean, look at this one. That one right there. That's a much different size than this one over here, which is probably twice the size. We could actually bring the size jitter up even more, 500%. Mega different, right? Might even be easier to see if we change that brush tip to a circle. General brushes. Oh, wait, let me just put brush tip over here. Circle. I'm going to bring the spacing up to, I don't know, 125.
There you go.
Now you see the spacing, right? Pretty dramatic. Let's go back to shape dynamics.
Oh,
minimum diameter. So you can set a minimum size for that size jitter. So say you want a lot of jitter. You want it to, but you don't want it to get too small. So say you don't want it to become really tiny, like that little fella there that I'm circling around, or this little fella here. You don't want it to be that small. Well, you can set a minimum size, minimum diameter, to, you know, say 50% of the default size of the brush. And you can do the same thing with, let's see, angle jitter. So if you have an angle right here, now it's a perfect circle, so you won't be able to tell. So let's make it a little oval, a real skinny oval. I'm gonna make a skinny oval like that for me. And then bring the spacing up real high, like, I don't know, 200, give or take. Got it? Now go back to shape dynamics. Go to angle. Now just actually draw a line of circles real quick. Okay, good. They're all facing the same angle. Am I wrong? Now bring your angle jitter up to 50%. You can kind of see what's going to happen down here. So go ahead and run your brush across your canvas. Did you get something similar to what I got here? If so, good. If not, something went wrong. You could turn angle jitter all the way up to 100% and it will just totally randomize the angles. And now this does not seem very useful with ovals, right? I can't imagine. Well, I don't know if you're like creating a Frankenstein monster and we're trying to create like messy stitches on its neck or arms, that might be useful. But typically you wouldn't use it with an oval. It's really useful for, actually ovals might be good for blades of grass. You know, no blade of grass is going to be at the exact same angle as another. So you might go angle jitter just a bit, maybe 4%. That's kind of looks like grass, right? Let's change the size jitter. That can be, I feel like that might be it. And then we can just change the angle because grass grows up more or less, right? Do a few rows of those. Not bad, right? Not bad grass. Way better than drawing every single little blade at a slightly different angle. So let's go back to shape dynamics. Roundness jitter is the same thing. We know what the roundness is. So we have it set real skinny, but we can set it to kind of choose. Okay, do we want it skinny or thinner? You know, like it might actually, the blade of grass example might work here. Is one blade of grass is never going to be exactly the same width as another. So let's see, roundness jitter. You can see in the preview here, it's just kind of randomizing their roundness. As you can see that little trail I left, this one's a very thin oval. This one's a much fatter oval, kind of a fat oval, a real thin one. We have the size jitter going too, so. The size jitter going, so it's trying to kind of make a bigger one, smaller ones. And last but not least, we have flip along the x-axis jitter. And that means that it's going to randomly flip the brush around. Same thing with flipping the Y jitter. And this is very useful for things like I was saying, spray paint, anything that kind of has like a spray effect. Is it would look kind of funny, especially if we had a very distinctive shape, like a star. It would be very apparent if every star were exactly the same orientation with the sharp part on the top and the two sharp ones on bottom. That wouldn't look right. So X and Y jitters will ensure that they're all flipped around in different directions. All right, let's talk about some scattering here. I'm going to use a tool that I didn't teach you real quick just to get rid of all this, but it's the eraser. Don't worry about that for now, though. I just didn't want to freak you out by using something I didn't show you and make you feel like, I should have known that. No, I'm jumping ahead. All right, scattering. So we were talking earlier about the effects of a spray paint can, right? Or an airbrush. I'm going to make it a circle. I'm going to make it perfectly round. Let's see. It just occurred to me that we did not go over hardness here. And this is very important. Set up for a circle, but why is it still an oval? Okay, I'm going to turn off shape dynamics because I think we set something over there that was making it an oval. So here we go. Perfect little circle. And you'll notice that hardness here, the little slider is all the way to the right, and it says 100%. Let's draw a line. Fair enough. Let's bring hardness down to 80%. Actually, you might not be able to recognize it that much. Yeah, now all the way down to 27%. You may not have seen a huge difference between this first example and this one, which is hardness, but you can definitely see the one that's down to 27% hardness, right? It's a lot softer around the edges. Let's bring it down all the way to like 7%. That's different, right? You can really see that it's a very soft kind of brush. That does not seem probably very useful at first when it comes to drawing, because what pen has a feathered edge like that? None, right? None, you know, there's no pen like that, or pencil, or piece of charcoal, or crayon, or anything, any actual physical medium, except for maybe an airbrush. You know, that does look like it kind of has an airbrushy effect, but it actually will come in a huge amount of handy because remember, Photoshop is not just for like drawing. It's also for modifying photos. It's for, touching up images that you've actually physically drawn or painted. So it has a lot of uses. And while we're on that topic, there's one more thing I wanted to go over, and that is the opacity. So opacity is a word that means how opaque something is. Opaque means not see-through. So my body is totally opaque, but a ghost would be only maybe 50% opacity. 20% opacity is quite a bit translucent, right? And we can adjust that, not over here, actually, but up here in our control panel. Right here, opacity says 100%. but I'm going to bring the brush tip's hardness all the way back up. Okay, so here's 100% opacity. Now let's bring it down to 50%, or 49. Right? It's almost like a ghost. Let's go down to 10%. What do you expect to see? Right, very light, very difficult to see. Now you might be wondering, well, why should I use opacity to make that gray color instead of just changing, like, you know, later you'll learn how to change the color to gray. Why not just change the color to gray? Here's why. Because this is not gray, it's actually still black. And you can find that out by running your brush over it a second time. See how it got darker? If you just used gray, it wouldn't change color. If you ran over it a second time, it'd still just be gray. Let's do it again. Notice how it gets darker every time. In fact, we did this enough times, it would eventually get all the way up to 100% opacity. I think it would take a long time, so we're only on 10%. But anyway, here's a shortcut to adjusting the opacity. You can press the number keys on your keyboard. So if you hit 2, 20%, 3, 30%, 4, 40%, you can see the opacity adjusting up here. 70%, 80%, 90%, you noticed they're still acting opaque. And then 100%, there it is. And oh, that was only 90%. You have to do it real quick. You have to hit 100 kind of quickly. If you do 10 real slowly like that, it'll stay at 10%. So now I'm at 100%, and you can see that when I go over it, it doesn't react. No such thing as 101% opacity. Only goes to 100. Oh, I know. All right, let's talk about scatter. So let's see, I'm gonna make the brush tip smaller. I'm gonna set scattering up to about 50%. No, 59%, I guess. Now let's go back to brush tip shape and bring your spacing up to maybe like 50%. You can see a little preview of what's going to happen. I want to spread the, you know, let's bring the spacing out higher. 125 is what mine landed on. I'm going to bring the scattering up to, actually, you know what, let's go higher. Do you see what's happening on the preview? As I bring the scattering up, I'm going to go to 360 something. It's the stamps for the brush tip are scattering farther from where my actual cursor lies. So if you bring scattering back down to 0, there's no scattering at all. It only stamps exactly where my cursor is at that moment. But bring it up to 100% and it'll go up to 100% of the brush widths. What am I trying to say? Goes 100% of how wide the brush is. It'll go that far away from the center of your actual cursor. Does that make sense? You can kind of see, actually, if we make the size. Can I get the idea? Not the best illustration, but the gist of the matter is, higher the scattering, the farther afield these little droplets are gonna go. And you can see how this would be really useful for like a spray paint can or a Jackson Pollock brush splat. Okay, go to brush tip. Make sure you have a circle size about 125. Hardness 100%, which you probably already do. Spacing around 100. And then let's go to scattering. Scatter at about 100%. Now let's move our count up to 3. Now you notice that here it's 1. Actually, every time it's 3. So 1. You can count 1, 2, 3 here. 1 and 2. You think, but actually that's 2 on top of each other. You can tell because it's darker. 1, again, there's two in one spot here. So every time it's three, it's just scattering three of these things. You could tell it to scatter a whole lot more. Actually, and then here you go. Here's count jitter. So it doesn't have to do three every time. Let's bring the count jitter up higher. And sometimes it'll do two, sometimes it'll do five, sometimes it'll do three. Like here, for example, here's three. One, two, three, here's four, here's three. One, two, three, four. I think this is four here. One, how about this one? One, two, three, four, five. This one's five. So let's do size jitter. Let's see, where was that? Shape dynamics, I believe. Let's see, size jitter. Let's get rid of that minimum diameter and let's see if we can create something that's like kind of like a spray paint can. Nah, it's not really like a spray paint can, but you know, it is kind of randomized and splatty and sprayish. So that's what these are all for. So that's pretty much all we're going to cover in this palette for now, except for one other little sort of tip. It's like sort of like a fun one that's not really as essential to the function, but does come in handy. It's called wet edges. So if you click this, click wet edges, then as you move your tip along, you're going to notice a few kind of darker areas. For example, right here, or right here when we change directions, especially when you change directions, like here or here. This is sort of intended to simulate the effect of a paintbrush as it moves along the canvas. As you know, it leaves a little bit extra along those curves when you move your brush. So that's the idea behind that. But just be aware that one of the side effects is it brings down the opacity. The opacity in your control panel up here will still say 100%, but actually it's not, because it's specifically trying to imitate sort of like a maybe an acrylic, but more like a watercolor. So anyway, that's sort of a like a fun one to experiment with, and I think it does add a little layer, a little touch of realism when you're trying to imitate some painting styles. All right, so we're gonna go over just a couple things on the control panel up here. So there's a little bit of redundancy built into Adobe Photoshop, actually a lot of Adobe products, is what you can do over here in the control panel. Well, you can also do it up here. I'm sorry, I meant to say what you can do in the palettes, you can also do in the control panel. There's also a bunch of shortcuts to do it. There are a lot of different ways to approach it. So let's go right here. You'll be able to save tool presets, but we're gonna talk about that later. It's just like if you get a tool tweaked in just the right way, then you can save it. So you don't have to sit there and go, oh, okay, let me open the brush settings. Let me change the scatter, change the size jitter, change all those settings again. You can just save it. Here's the size and the hardness and some of the brush tips. We're actually going to go to, we touched on brush tips in our last lesson, but we're going to go into it a little bit more deeply in a minute. Mode, I don't think you necessarily need to know right now. But suffice it to say, probably keeping it on normal for now is just fine. But they do actually have some pretty significant differences. Of course, you know, opacity you can change here because we went over that earlier. Flow, actually, the best way to explain flow is just to demonstrate it. Go ahead and go to a blank area of your canvas and keep flow at 100%, and you're just going to see a dark black line. Bring it down to 1%. You're going to see a very faint line, just like if you had brought opacity down to 1%, right? And watch this. I'm going to crosshatch that line. See how it got darker? So that's just like opacity, right? So flow seems to be a little bit like opacity. Let's bring it to 50%. If it's like opacity, it'll be sort of like in the middle of that darkness and that darkness, right? Actually, that's darker than I expected. Let's bring it down. Anyway, so but the effect seems to be sort of similar to opacity, right? But here's the difference. I'm gonna bring flow back up to its default, which is 100%. I'm gonna bring opacity down to 50, and I'm gonna draw a loop-de-loop. Okay. It just looks like one solid. It doesn't really look like I took a marker, like a, you know, magic marker, and did a loop-de-loop, right? Because if I had taken a magic marker, it would be darker, right there where I crossed over my own line. So the markers are not totally opaque. They're quite translucent. So it would get darker. But that's not the way transparency works. It acts like it's one solid stamp. Whereas flow is Photoshop's attempt to make it a little bit more natural. I'm going to take that down to actually pretty low so you can actually see it happen. I'm going to do a loop-de-loop. See, that looks more like an actual marker or like an actual paint stroke because it gets darker where it goes over itself. Right? So it's a bit like opacity, except for it's an attempt to simulate an actual paintbrush or actual marker. So the default's 100, so let's go back up to that. All right, I think. Oh, right, brush tips. So as I mentioned, Photoshop comes equipped with a number of brush tips. So feel free to experiment around. I'm not even going to go over very many of them. You can download more off the web. But everything you do in this class, you'll be able to do perfectly fine with the default set of brush tips. Here are some dry media ones like charcoal, some wet media like paints. So feel free to experiment. I know we went over this a little bit over the last lesson, so that's fine. All right, now let's move on to the next tool. Now this is gonna be a real easy one because Now this is gonna be a real easy one because most of the controls work exactly the way the brushes do, and it's the eraser tool. So you have a little cursor here, and you just move it over whatever you want to erase, and it just removes all the ink on the layer. Simple enough, right? You can adjust the size exactly the same way. You can adjust the hardness. So you get the idea. It's an eraser. We all know what erasers are. So I wanted to jump back into our brushes just for a moment because there was one point I forgot to bring up earlier. And that is for those of us using a tablet. So here's my Wacom Intuos, the one I think I mentioned. I think I got it off eBay or Amazon used for 30 or 40 bucks. But it's the one I use the most often because it's lightweight, little pen, it's simple. If you break it, I toss it in my backpack, if it breaks, I'm out 30 or 40 bucks until I get a new, it may have even been cheaper, it may have been 20 bucks. Whereas there are so many, other tools that are just so much more expensive. So I'd rather not drag it around in my backpack wherever I go. So honestly, I drag my computer around my house. I'm upstairs in my bedroom right now, but I do most of my work downstairs on my couch. So, back and forth here and there, pardon me, I do it at the kitchen table while my kids are eating. So this is just a lot more portable. And there are a few brushes here in the brushes palette that only apply to tablets. And by the way, for those of us who do have one, I don't need to explain this to you. You probably discovered that you just put your pen on the, close to the tablet and you can move your mouse around. But the camera might note that I'm not touching the tablet. But when I do touch the tablet, that's when it starts. Oh, I have the eraser set on there. Now brush. So you can see I'm not touching the tablet. When I do touch it, that's when it starts to draw. I lift up my pen. It's not drawing, put down my pen, and it's drawing again. So that's how these tablets work. You have to look at the screen, not your tablet, when you're drawing. But you get used to it. It seems awkward at first, but you do get used to it fairly quickly. And you have a little right mouse button and a left mouse button right there on your pen. I don't know if you can see it in my light. There we go. Now you'll see that some of these say soft round pressure size. What's pressure size? Well, when you're using a mouse, that doesn't do anything at all. It'll always be just totally normal. But if you're using a tablet, it does that. Hard round, pressure size. Same deal. And let's see. And this is really useful if you're doing all sorts of styles of art. If anybody in the audience uses can speak Chinese or can read Chinese, forgive my terrible writing. But anyway, it gives it a little bit more of a calligraphy brush look. So I really like my tablet. You can pick them up fairly cheaply online. So anyway, that was just a side note for anybody who's using a tablet. Now let's take a break from the tools for a moment and talk about a couple palettes that are going to be really important for us, especially in this upcoming assignment, the weekly exercise. So the first one is the history palette. Ah, here it is. The history palette is here on my screen, but it probably won't be there on your screen. So if it's not there at all, does anybody recall where you can, you know, you can find it again? All right, if you said window, you got it. Remember, most of the palettes are found in window. Click that, click history. I'll make mine disappear. Now it's gone. I'll click history again, and it'll come back. Now, most of us know what undo is. Here's the keyboard shortcut. It's hold Control Z on a PC, or Command Z on a Mac. And it just undoes last move. And you can undo a few moves in Photoshop. You can change the settings and how many. I think I have mine set for about 50 or maybe 10 undos. But history can go back really far and very specifically give you pinpointed moments in your history when you can revert back to and then start working fresh. So take the pieces of Chinese calligraphy. I didn't want to do this character for water. Shui. So let's get rid of Shui. Let's see, I didn't want to do zi either. The character for zi has, I don't know, literal translation, I don't think. But now, there, I'm good with this character, which means big. It's da. And I want to, I want to say, I want to talk about a big fire instead of that nonsense I had before. Da hua. Now, you'll notice that I started building a new history after that point. So all the other stuff is gone. So forget about the other stuff. It's history. But you can't get it back. But I could go back again. Now I'm back to this character called Da, which means big. Now notice that we still have access to come back to these. Let's go back to here. Okay. And now I'm gonna spell a different word. Da-ren, or Da, I forgot to say it in Chinese, but it's a big man. But notice, I can't get fire, that character I had before, the fire, back. It's gone. So bear in mind, reverting back in history can be a little dangerous, but it can also be very useful. But remember, once you revert back to a point in your history and then start making new moves on top of that, those moves that you had before, they're pretty much gone. So that's your history timeline, or your history palette. Let's look at your layers. So right now we've been working, you come with one layer, it's always called background, and it has an eyeball over here, a little representation of it right here, and then a lock on it. And that's default. The lock means you can't throw it away. See, if I drag it down to this little trash icon, this trash can, I'm clicking on it, I can't use it. I can't drag it down and put it in there. You can't do a lot, you can draw on it, but you can't do quite a number of other things to it. So here are a few other icons. Here's create a new layer, and that's the one you'll be doing most. Actually, let's just do that for now because the other ones get a little bit more complicated. Now we have new layer number one, and this checker pattern is Photoshop's way of telling you that the layer is transparent. So I'm having deja vu. I feel like we talked about this in your last lesson, but layers are like putting different layers of cellophane on top of each other. Traditional animators use these things called cells or cellophanes. They draw, say, a background on one, then they put another piece that was transparent. They draw the main character, and then they put another one on top, and they draw the second character in the scene, and then they do another one on top, and they draw like a prop, like a baseball or something. And this was because if they wanted to change, if they decided, okay, in this cartoon, we don't want Elmer Fudd to be talking to Bugs Bunny. We want to get rid of him and replace him with Yosemite Sam. They didn't have to go like trash the whole cell that had Bugs Bunny, the background, Yosemite Sam, and the ball. They just had to take one piece out. And that's exactly what our layers do for us. So go ahead And on your own canvas, create a new layer. Draw a circle. Now go to layer number one there. Thinking of. Draw a triangle. Now, what if we had done this on one layer and we decided, oh, you know what? I like the triangle, but I don't like the circle. We would have to take the eraser. We'd have to very carefully try to get rid of that circle. Okay, that's pretty good, but up here it's gonna get a little tricky. Okay, that's okay looking. But it's kind of a challenge, right? You can see that I made, left a little imperfection here. You know, then you have to get real careful up in this area. Not a great solution, right? By the way, redo. So we have undo is Control Z or Command Z. If you hold that plus Shift and then press Z, that's redo, by the way. A little shortcut for you. So if we turn out, if we have them all in separate layers, we can actually just delete one layer. And we don't have to do all that careful erasing. Now, just FYI, we can't delete the background because it has this lock. So if you want to unlock it, just click the lock and it goes away. And I'll trash it. And voila, that layer is gone. I'm going to hit undo to bring it back. Now, another note about layers is you'll notice that we can see both of these layers, but you can turn any one of them invisible briefly, actually for as long as you want, just by clicking the eye. This is really useful for trying to figure out, especially if you kind of, I mean, it's useful for a lot of things. Sometimes you want to just see how something looks without an element. A lot of times if I have like 30 layers, I'll click the eye just to kind of like try to remember what, you know, what is that on the layers. I have to admit to committing a Photoshop sin, I forget to name the layers when I create them, and that you do want to do that. Name them something other than layer zero, layer one. They're easy to remember now, but when you have 30, 40 layers, it gets really hard to remember. So name them something that makes sense. And if you forget, oh, what did this layer have? And the picture is too tiny that you can't see it, or just click the eye and it should remind you, oh, okay, I see that thing disappear and reappear. That's what's on the layer. And you can also reshuffle them. So you can bring this circle up above the triangle. Now you're thinking the triangle disappeared. Why did it do that? Well, that's because the background here is white. So it's not like a cell. It's not like a transparent background. It's a white background. So it's like taking a white piece of paper and slapping it on top of another drawing. You can't see it anymore, but it's still there. So yeah, I brought it back on top here. In fact, if we were to take our eraser tool and erase some of this, you'll see that the triangle actually is down below. There it is. So anyway, that's the long and short of layers. So here's your first part of this week's exercise. Not all of it, but this is the first part. Let's draw our buddy, Buzzy, the Fullerton College mascot. You know Buzzy the Hornet? My machine is processing slowly. So I'm gonna start on one layer. And I'm just gonna draw him. You can use whatever brush tip you want. Whatever tool, you can use your mouse, you can use your Wacom tablet, just use all the skills that you've learned so far with the brush tool and draw Buzzy. Sketch style, freehand. So that's the first part. So go ahead, I'm gonna go ahead and do this assignment myself and then I'm gonna put it in fast forward. All right, it looks like I got everything here. So you'll notice that I decided to put my sketchwork on a separate layer down here. I can get rid of the ink and check out the original sketch. Or I can just get rid of the sketch and just look at the final ink. I mean, obviously, if this were going to a publication, you'd want to put a lot more work into it. The lines are very wobbly, and you can kind of clean those up by thickening them up and using the eraser tool to smooth them out. But you get the impression that, or you get the idea that you can use layers to really help you out in works like this. Okay, so that's the first part of this assignment. The next part is we're going to open up a new document and work on a couple other tools. So let's go up to New. We're going to open a document exactly. Oh, you know what? Before we move on, I'd like to discuss the importance of document size. So we went over this very briefly, kind of breezed over it last time, but we've been using 2000 by 2000 pixels. Now, incidentally, these things sort of equate to things in the real world in a way. So, I mean, it's totally virtual, right? But if we have a 9-point pencil tip and we're working on a document that's, you know, very small and we try to expand it, it's going to look very pixelated. Or if we're working on a huge document that's 1,000 inches by 1,000 inches and we're using a 9-point tip and you look at it like this, like a, you know, like this size on your screen, you're not going to see that 9-point pencil line at all. It's going to be so fine that it'll disappear. So actually, document size is a really important consideration when you're getting ready to do a piece of art. I think with any design, whether it be an artistic design or probably an engineering design, I think it's all true that you need to consider the context, because it's an oft overlooked, especially by students, often overlooked. Just, oh yeah, well, you just make a document, you draw your picture, and you turn it in, and that's it. Well, let's think of it this way. Let's say your drawing is going to be blown up onto a billboard. I mean, if you do it on a 1,000 by 1,000 canvas, it's going to look not so great. Unless it's being viewed from very far away, in which case it might be okay. or let's say it's going to be on a poster. If it's going to be on a poster that's about notebook size, your drawing will probably look pretty good, because a 2,000 pixel by 2,000 pixels is about like this, you know, to give you like a real life basic idea. So if you're going to blow it up to a notebook or put it on a piece of notebook paper, which is 8.5 by 11, and just post it in the hallway at your school, like, oh, hey, come to, you know, Susie's barbecue or whatever, you're probably cool. But if you're going to blow it up to a big poster size, you know, those 2-foot by 3-foot ones, you blow it up to that, you're going to see the pixels real easily. So it's not going to look good at all. So it's a super important consideration. Let me show you the effect of the tools have on different canvas sizes. So I'm going to open a very small document. I'm going to make it 200. You know what? Let's go inches, just to give you a more real life physical sense of these dimensions. Let's make it a square again, 5 inches by 5 inches. It's a pretty small document, right? I mean, a piece of paper that's a little larger than a post-it note, but not a lot larger. And let's start drawing. Let's see, we have a 10-point. This is exactly the width of the stroke I was using for Buzzy. Seems okay. Until we try to blow it up to poster size. This would probably be how it would look on a notebook paper. Look at that pixelation. Look at that. That's, you know, all this aliasing is what they call that. This like pixelated, rocky stair step kind of appearance. We don't want that, right? So we would not want to use a 5-inch by 5-inch canvas if we need something about the size of a piece of notebook paper, because it's going to look pixelated. Let's open another one. Let me show you the opposite. Now say it's going to be a piece of notebook paper. We make the mistake of opening a file 100 inches. 100 inches. Can you calculate what that is in feet? I don't know off the top of my head, but it's got to be, you know, probably 8 feet wide by 8 feet tall. Like, this is a wall. Let's start drawing with that same brush tip, same size. So is that the effect we wanted? Do we want it to be a really, really thin itty bitty line? Now we can make it thicker. But what if we open a 100 inch by 100 inch document like this, and we draw this really detailed drawing, like, oh, we have like a city, we're gonna draw a city here. Let me bring my stroke size back to what it was. And we're gonna draw all sorts of cool stuff, like, oh wow, it's gonna be a little city here, we're gonna have a door. Okay, so I skipped ahead. I drew a happy little city scene with a couple little happy little aliens. Draw a couple more little buildings, maybe a weird alien tree, little alien leaves with some details, lots of good detail. There we go. Okay, now let's zoom out to notebook size. Trying to visualize a notebook, yeah. So this, what you're seeing on your scene, looks about notebook size. Now, I feel like I could still recognize what these are, but it's a very tiny detail drawing, right? And it's not the same effect as you have here, right? In fact, this is not even a notebook size. Let me, probably this is what it would look like on a notebook. So this kind of looks like what you'd get if you took a rather thin Sharpie and traced your ink over, your pencil over with ink, you know, one of those finer Sharpies. But this looks like a very, you know, if you printed this out, I think it would look like a rather thin, fine ballpoint pen, like somebody getting in there doing like these itty bitty little drawings. It definitely looks like a larger image that has been shrunken down. And that's a really cool look if that's what you're going for. But you have to be aware that if you're going to draw something really big, and then, you know, on a big canvas, like 100 by 100, which is what we have here, 100 inches by 100 inches, and then shrink it down, it's gonna look shrunk down. It's gonna look like somebody drew it bigger, but then it shrunk it, and now it's really tiny and detailed. So just be aware that it matters. You know, don't just open a random size document and expect it to be fine. It's important that you try to, not that you match the size that you want to print. Very often, if I'm gonna print, say, you know, like a 2-foot by 3-foot sign, I often will make it that larger than it needs to be because I don't know, maybe it's my style, but I tend to like drawing a little bigger and then shrinking it down, probably because a lot of times it hides the imperfections. And if I, you know, if my hand is shaky and I'm over the eraser, there's a little wobble to it, you shrink it down, it's not as visible to the naked eye. But also it just looks a little tighter, has a little more detail. So, and you may or may not know that comic books are usually drawn quite a bit bigger than they're published for that reason. That's why comic books look so detailed. They don't look like somebody drew them with a pen. It's because they're drawn twice as big and shrunk down. Anyway, here's the next assignment or exercise. This may as well, anyway, let's get rid of this canvas. It's way too big. This is 100 by 100 inches. I want to get rid of that. Do not save it. This is only 5 inches by 5 inches. That's not going to do the job. So we're going to get rid of that. Do not save it. Let's open something that's, I don't know, 12 by 18. How's that sound? Oops. Go to file, new. Say width 18 inches, height 12 inches. Create. Cool. Now go ahead and pick. Oh, now here's the first thing we're going to do. So we're going to go over choosing colors, and then we're going to go over two more tools called Dodge and Burn, which sounds, now that I think about it, a really fun game, like a really extreme version of Dodgeball. Okay, so go over to this little box here. I introduced this to you last week. Double click on the black box. You're gonna see this big color picker thing. You'll see this on a lot of visual art software. So get used to seeing it. It's just a way of picking colors. You kind of choose the basic color over here, and then you select the what they call saturation over here. Saturation, by the way, just means how much white or black is mixed into the paint in a way. So like if you get a pure blue tube of paint, you can mix a little black into it, like mix a little white into it, but the purer the blue, the more saturated it is. So if we go all the way to the left, there's no color at all, actually. So let's just go to like a middle of the road type of gray. I don't know. You know, truth is, I just know that 888888 happens to be a very neutral, middle-of-the-road kind of gray, so I'm just going to type that in. You can type that in too. Let's make a bigger brush. I'm going to go for like 300 pixels-ish. Zoom out of the canvas. Yeah. I'm going to stamp six little gray circles. Oh, that's eraser. I'm going to hit B, the key B for brush. Bring up the size to about 300-ish. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I'd like you to do the same. Now, let's zoom in on this one in the upper left-hand corner, because that's the one we're going to work with first. I'm going to go up here and click. Actually, for you, it should look like this little lollipop. And that's actually called the dodge tool, or it might look like this little pinchy finger thingy. That's called the burn tool, or it might actually look like this spongy thing called the sponge tool. Usually it starts with the dodge tool. By the way, these icons make reference to photography techniques that predate digital photography. So I was never much of a photographer. I kind of did some photography, but I stepped in the digital photography era. So if you ask somebody 10, 15 years older than me, they might be able to explain this. I cannot, sorry. But if we click the dodge tool, what it does is it's going to darken the image. So let's run this over in our little circle. Oh, I'm sorry. It's going to lighten it. Okay, so that's not what our goal is. What we're going to try to do is make this ball look a little bit more realistic. So I'm going to bring it, we're going to make it look like a ball, like a pool ball or something. I'm going to bring the size up real big, and I'm going to make it really, 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 really soft. Okay, let's go bigger. All right, I'm just going to click. Now I'm going to bring the size down. Click, size down, click. 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 Oops. Size down, click. Let's zoom out. That has a little bit of a shine to it now, right? So that's kind of what the dodge tool does. Lightens things up. You don't have to use it like that. You could, you know, do this. And I often do this whenever I'm trying to lighten an area on a photo, or not as often with the images that I draw, but very often with photos. Let's go to burn. So can anybody guess what the burn tool does? If you guess burning your photo, that's wrong. It makes it darker. So this is going to be a little trickier because the shadow should be back here, right? So let's swipe it across. And again, and again, and then just a little bit more, and a little bit more. There. Not bad. Yeah, looks a little more realistic, right? All right, so here's the reason that we did six, and this is your assignment this week, is I want you to choose six textures that you can see in your home or, you know, just around you in the world. Try to replicate those textures. So you can see here that this is a mildly shiny, like a plastic ball, like from a ball pool at Chuck E. Cheese or, you know, Incredible John's Pizza or, you know, wherever your kids go to play. But the way that the light plays on the surface of an object will be different for every object. So I'd like you to go ahead and make six. Fabric, crumpled paper bag. But the challenge for you is you have to try to make it look round. So if you have a crumpled paper bag, that's fine. But how are you going to make it look like the light is shining on a ball and try to make it look like a crumpled up paper bag? You know, what else? I mean, or use your imagination. Try to make some that look like they're dripping with slime. I'm going to do one as an example. I decided on trying to do some burlap, make it look like a burlap wrapped ball and try to make it look real just with the dodge and burn tools on these ones. So we're done with the brush tool for this exercise. I want you to exercise your use of the dodge and burn tool. And that's the assignments. You have the buzzy sketch, and you have these dodged and burned, dodge and burnt, I don't know, tool balls. So send them both to me in JPEGs, and we're good for the week. This is due next Monday at noon, just like the last assignment. So, and if you have any questions, you know where to find me. All right, so I finished with one ball here. I might have gone over time a little bit on this one because we have six, and I think I just spent about half an hour. So it might have been more, might have been 45 minutes. That's too long to get six balls done. You might want to spend like 15 minutes on each one. 15, 20, or I'm sorry, 15, 30, 45. Yeah. Sounds about right. Hour and a half, and plus buzzy is probably half an hour. 2 hours worth of work. So I would expect this buzzy plus the texture balls to be like 2 to 3 hours. So anyway, you might not want to include this much detail, but the thing I liked about doing the burlap is it's very irregular. So it's sort of forgiving when you're not pre-planning this. You notice I didn't sketch it out first. I didn't draw any kind of like lines. Okay, here's one fiber. And then, okay, the horizontal lines, here are the other fibers. Because burlap is so messy that you can kind of be messy, and it still, and that's how you make it look like burlap. If you're really precise, it won't look like burlap. It'll look like some like very much nicer type of fabric. And then also burlap is not very shiny. So I did not, obviously. So I did not give it a nice little shiny point there. I left it a lot duller. You know, I didn't bring the brush down too tight. I didn't want to give it a shiny point on it. Dull things like my hand, you can't see a little point. There's a lamp right there. You can't see a point reflecting on it. It's very dull. So anyway, you want to do that for all the rest of the balls here. Send it to me as a JPEG and you'll be all set.